Elizabeth Garcia was raised in Far. Although her parents, Lorenzo and Ercile Garcia, didn't have an opportunity to go to college, they were still successful entrepreneurs, and they ran a corner store right next to their home.
My father and mother had a convenience store there at the corner of Bell and Dogwood, and that's where I grew up. My parents always said, if you're having a bad day, you leave your bad day at home, and you come to the store and work, and with a smile.
The youngest of four children, Lisa, as she's known to her friends, started her education like her siblings at a Catholic grade school at the San Juan Shrine.
An airplane crashed into the shrine in San Juan. At that time, that's when we were going to school there, but right after that, they closed. And so I ended up going to public school, started at Buell School. I had two teachers that were very influential, Mrs. Llewellyn and Mrs. Curtis, in third and fourth grade. And those are the teachers that exposed us to their European trips in the summer.
Europe seemed like another world to Lisa, a world she longed to see for herself.
Thereafter, I ended up going to Buckner, and after that, Jefferson was still called Jefferson Junior High, and that's also when I started getting involved in student body activities, and then in eighth grade, ran for office and was vice president at LBJ Junior High.
Lisa's father, Lorenzo, influenced her involvement in student council.
He was always politically involved, always helping someone run for office or helping just the community.
After attending PSJA Ninth Grade Center, she began her sophomore year at PSJA High School.
I had Hilda Garza, who's now Hilda Garza DeShazo, as my sophomore English teacher. She was also very positive about making sure that students were going to go to college.
Lisa had been in band since the sixth grade, and she continued into high school where she played the clarinet. She made plenty of friends in band.
And those have been my lifelong friends. And I had a great time. Another person that was extremely disciplined, that taught us a lot of discipline, was Mr. Pete Cisnettos, our band director. He was a no-nonsense kind of guy.
She attributes much of the discipline it took to finish college to her band director, Pete Cisnettos. Her sophomore English teacher, Hilda Garza, offered Lisa a chance to fulfill her childhood dream.
She said, I'm actually involved with a group called AIFS, stands for American Institute of Foreign Studies, and we're wanting to sponsor students to go to Europe for the summer. And it's a matter of one thing, looking at and being exposed to stuff by pictures and or reading about it or watching movies, actually being there. It was one of the best times of my life.
During her senior spring break, her government teacher, E.J. Ballou, organized a trip to Washington, D.C.
You know, going to the Supreme Court, going to the Capitol, visiting the museums, Smithsonian museums up and along the mall. He was also very, very positive about make sure you could go to college, you end up, you know, pursuing a degree, pursuing some sort of career. The other person that was probably the most influential was Mr. Bonus, my English teacher, my senior year. I had a real difficult time in that class for some reason, and for some reason I just didn't really want to pay attention spring semester of my senior year. But he took me aside because I wasn't doing really well. I was already senior fever by that time. He took me aside and he says, "Don't let up." He says, "You know you're on your way to college." I was already admitted to UT by that time. He said, "Because I promise you that if you think it's hard now," he said, "just wait till you go to college." He says, "You're going to be on your own. No, there's not going to have any parents to tell you what to do. It's going to be all about self-discipline."
After graduating from PSJA High School in 1983, there was only one university that Lisa had wanted to attend since she was a little girl.
I had an uncle that my mom's youngest brother, who was already at UT, and I must have been about 5 or 6 years old when we ended up driving up to Austin and moving him, from one apartment to the other, and actually got exposed to the university. And that was pretty much when I got the bite. I mean, I was the bug, I should say, rather, to go to that university.
When she was young, Lisa's father took her to the Hidalgo County Courthouse. And from that moment, she wanted to be a lawyer.
I walked into a courtroom and realized, he explained to me what was going on, and that's when I said, this is exactly what I want to do.
Lisa's ultimate goal was to practice law. However, at the University of Texas, she worked towards a business administration degree in finance and international business.
I thought, I need something to fall back on. You know, I need some business. My parents were businessmen, and so I wanted to learn that aspect.
One of the hardships Lisa had to face in college was the passing of her father.
There are times when I felt that, especially after losing my father, that I almost didn't go back to UT. For my junior year, I thought I'll stay here and I'll help my mom in the store and go to Pan Am and stuff. And she said, absolutely not. It's just unfortunate that I lost my father at a very young age, but he was someone that I truly followed his footsteps because he was on the city council when he passed away at the time. Very giving.
She graduated with a business administration degree from the University of Texas in 1987. She then spent a couple of years in the private sector before enrolling in law school at Texas Southern University in Houston. They were upfront about how difficult the program was.
When you go to orientation for law school, and the dean tells you, look to your left, look to your right, because a person next to you is not going to be there at the end of your first year, that grabs your attention.
A constant source of encouragement as she was going through law school was her mother. Lisa's mother was able to make it to her law school graduation ceremony.
She was there, and my uncle, who was still living there in Austin, her little brother, and his wife were there, too. It's a big swearing-in ceremony, it's what it is, and they give you your license.
Lisa began to practice law in August of 1992.
I love what I do. It's like they say, you'll never really work if you enjoy what you do on an everyday basis. It's really worthwhile. Litigating and being in front of jurors is something that I really enjoy, defending cases. And when we have to settle cases, we have to settle them for the right reasons.
Lisa returned to the Valley in 2003.
After being away for 20 years, you start reevaluating your life and your path. And I realized my mother was getting up in age, and I really wanted to reconnect to my culture, to my roots.
Then Lisa refocused her attention on her career.
I started from scratch. I started at the DA's office across the street because I had clerked there between my first and second year of law school. And Mr. Guetta said, sure. He said, you know, welcome back. And I got a job as assistant DA. And I was there for a little over a year.
After working with attorney Stephen Haynes for about a year, they both joined a law firm that is now known as Vidauri, Lyde, Rodriguez, and Haynes, where she currently practices civil defense litigation. Aside from her career, while in college, Lisa was also involved in a mentorship program.
And I mentored a lot of those students, and one of them is now a district judge in our neighboring county, in Cameron County. One of them's a county commissioner there. I mean, and this really, really good story is that I get to see that these students have gone to do great things.
Lisa is a proponent of individual responsibility.
At the end of the day, you're pretty much the master of your own destiny. And it's like I tell my nephew right now, you're on your own. You're driving this train.
Many of Lisa's teachers had a lasting influence on her life.
There's people in your life, like they say, they're in for a reason or for a season, for a lifetime. And even though I might not see them often, I remember. I remember the words that they told me, and it's like they said, I mean, they had just been there. You know, they're professors and or teachers for a reason. I truly believe that it's the way you grow up starts with your foundation at home and with the guidance that you receive.
Lisa has had a successful life. And she emphasizes to young people that the key to success is a good education.
Education is the key to every door, and I cannot stress that enough. As long as you have a goal of achieving some sort of education that you're going to be happy with and enjoy doing, and achieving that goal, it doesn't matter how long it takes you, as long as you keep pursuing it.
As a PSJA alumnus, Lisa has no regrets.
There have been times when people ask me, if you had to do it all over again, what would you change? Absolutely nothing. I wouldn't change it. You know, I had a great childhood and a great experience at PSJA.